Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. I suppose it's probably the last time I'll get a chance to say this, but I hope everyone has a very happy new year and that it brings everything that they want. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. We have consideration whether to take items three and four in private. Item three is to consider the evidence we will hear today on the biodiversity delivery plans, and item four is to consider our work programme. Are we happy to see to take these items in private? We are. So the first item on business today, as agenda item two, is an evidence session on the draft delivery plan to accompany the Scottish Government's new biodiversity strategy. The committee is continuing work we started in late 2022 when we took evidence on the draft strategy. On the 12th of December, we discussed the delivery plan with a panel of experts on marine biodiversity. This morning, we will hear from a panel of experts and stakeholders to discuss the terrestrial aspects of the plan. I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Caroline Brown, the Director of Scotland, Ireland and English Regions Royal Town Planning Institute, Sarah Cowie, the Policy Manager for the National Farmers Union, Dr. Paul Walton, Head of Habitats and Species RSPB Scotland, and Bruce Wilson, the Head of Policy Advocacy of the Scottish Wildlife Trust. I would say that also that joining us remotely is Ailsa Raeburn, who's the chairperson for the Community Land Scotland. I should point out to those people watching and committee members that Dr. Hannah Rudman, who was also was down to attend as a witness, has been unable to attend today. Thank you, all of those that have attended, for joining us. And I'm pleased to welcome both Finlay Carson and Rhoda Grant from the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee, who are in attendance for today's evidence session. You'll both get a chance to ask questions nearer to the end of the evidence session. We are going to spend about 90 minutes on this session, and we're going to move straight into committee members' questions, but before we do, because the evidence will take will follow the biodiversity strategy on land, I'm going to make a voluntary declaration of interest and remind members that in my register of interest I show that I am a member of a family farming partnership, and we do farm land, and that I'm also involved in a wild salmon fishery where I'm a partner. So both of those have a involvement possibly in where we're discussing this morning. Full details can be found in my register of interest. So on that note, I'm going to turn to the first questions, which come from Douglas Lumsden. Douglas.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. First question I have, and it's in sort of two parts. The first part is, do you feel you've been engaged in the development of the plan, and has it been meaningful engagement? And the second part of my first question is, do you feel that the plan takes into account the potential socio-economic impacts of the proposed actions? And I'll probably ask Caroline first of all, because you're nearest to me, to go first, and then we'll probably move around.
Before you head off on it, what I would say to you, there's quite a lot of people, there's a panel of five, as it were. So if somebody said something that you would say, it is absolutely acceptable for you to say, well, I agree, and don't repeat it all. Otherwise, I'm not going to get through all my questions. But if you don't agree, then obviously, and you want to come in and you haven't been brought in, just raise your hand. Caroline, sorry.
Thank you, committee, and thanks for this opportunity to be here this morning. To answer the question, the RTPI has not been involved, to my knowledge, in the preparation of this delivery plan, but we have been involved in some of the other specific actions that are part of the plan, for example, on the technical advice group, coordinated by the planning team in the Scottish Government, which has just produced its draft on biodiversity guidance on Policy 3 in NPF 4. So, no is the short answer to the engagement in this particular document, but we are engaged in activities on parts of the actions that are in this. And I think on the second part of your question about socio-economic impacts, one of the things that strikes us about the delivery plan at the moment is that it doesn't say very much about areas which are very deficient in nature. And this is a policy approach that other places have used. For example, in London, they've mapped nature-deficient places, and that is a starting point for interventions. And I think this is concerns us in a sense that some of the urban environments are not represented in this action plan. Urban environments which are currently very deficient in nature and where the poorest or most marginalised communities might be living and where the opportunity for intervention and action on biodiversity is really great, because there's very, very little there at the moment. I think there's something about that that's missing from this plan. I'm sure I can expand on that, but I don't want to use up too much time.
Okay. Thanks, Gavina.
Hello, and thank you for having NFUS along to the committee. I would say that in terms of engagement, yes and no. I think NFUS are quite well engaged with Nature Scotland, with Scottish Government on the development of this plan, and farmers and crofters are obviously crucial to solving the biodiversity crisis, so it's essential that we have that engagement. So on the one hand, yes, we are engaged, but I don't think that the depth and the breadth of engagement was enough. I think farming and agriculture, you know, it's such a broad sector. We have so many different farm types, farm sizes, farming practices in Scotland, that to fully engage with the whole sector, that actually needed to be a bit better. So I lead our Environment and Land Use Committee. That's made up of farmers from all across Scotland and represents different farming types, and they were the committee that led on the responding to this consultation. So, you know, I engaged with them quite a lot on this. What we did was actually did our own engagement, and so we spoke with our Environment and Land Use Committee and delivered those results back to Nature Scotland, back to Scottish Government about what we would like to see going forward. And that process isn't just going to stop there. It's not going to stop when the deadline for this consultation closed. We are going to continue that into this year. So what we're going to do is look at these delivery plan actions a bit further in the first half of this year. We're going to undertake focus groups with our members across Scotland, and we're going to then feed those results back to Nature Scotland and see what more can be done to engage on this plan. And we're very happy to share with the committee the results of those focus groups. So yes, farmers are involved, and yes, NFUS has been involved in the engagement of this plan, but we think that could go well further in order to get the kind of wide depth and breadth of farming practices and experiences and take that into account. We think the timelines for consultation are very short, you know, the 12 weeks or 14 weeks or however long it was at the end of last year. That's just not long enough for organisations to fully engage on all of the 150 or so actions in the delivery plan. So the timelines are challenging, but we think that it's very crucial that Scottish Government and Nature Scotland, they don't close the door at the end of the consultation period. They do keep up that engagement, and if that's not forthcoming from then as NFUS as an organisation, we'll do that ourselves and make sure our members are heard. In terms of the socio-economic impacts, this is a concern as well. Obviously, farming in rural communities, farming is undergoing a lot of pressures at the minute. We're being asked to deliver on climate, nature, food, biodiversity, and rural communities. So there's a lot that farmers have been asked to deliver, and we want to make sure that the socio-economic impacts are well and truly understood so that we can kind of mitigate those in terms of going forward.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, and thanks for having me here, and thanks for the question. It's a good one. The previous Scottish biodiversity strategy ran until 2020. Okay, so we've had sort of three years late almost with this one. And in the previous one, there was a Scottish Biodiversity Committee which was chaired by the Cabinet Secretary and had on it representatives from NFUS, from COSLA, local authorities, and from environmental NGOs, Scottish Environment Link, RSPB, Scottish Wildlife Trust. So it was a very collegiate approach, and that was the top table of biodiversity in this country. Since then, there has been an absolute sea change in the engagement of non-government stakeholders in the development of this plan, actually. So there was, to begin with, for a lengthy initial period of development of this plan, very little engagement directly with environmental NGOs, which is problematic in several fronts, because we do have expertise in our employees and indeed in our volunteers, but also we are bound to be quite important delivery partners for all of this, because we have, for example, we can access funding that government bodies can't access. We have delivery capacity on the ground. Scottish Wildlife Trust, RSPB, have people out there employed in Scotland in the right areas for biodiversity. So this has been quite a long-running point that we've been trying to make to government, that we feel that our engagement hasn't been sufficient. And indeed, we are told by external funders like NLHF, the National Heritage Lottery Fund, for example, that they really need government and NGOs to come together with an agreed plan to make sure your priorities align and then come with a coherent ask to us. They're being very explicit about that. And it does make it quite difficult. I suspect what has happened is that there's been a very serious attempt to mainstream biodiversity across government in the development of this plan. I think an awful lot of that engagement has been within the government family. And we are told by Nature Scotland that that is why it's been really difficult to engage the non-government family. And maybe we'll come on to that, but I think the success in that endeavour has perhaps been a little bit patchy. So, I actually think that... As an environmental NGO, I think we have been held rather at arm's length until the latter stages, when there were a series of workshops which are very constructive and which we're very grateful for, and we had a chance to input latterly. But I think, broadly speaking, this is not the kind of co-designed delivery plan that we really anticipated and looked forward to. And I think maybe there will be some teething troubles and some things to address in response to that. On the second point, the socioeconomic impacts, it's a massive question. I mean, biodiversity loss is a global crisis, and Scotland is part of it. The Intergovernmental Panel on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, IPBES, which is the biodiversity equivalent of the IPCC for climate change, has said we're losing biodiversity now at a rate faster than ever before in human history, and has been absolutely crystal clear that this is an emergency in terms of the welfare of the living world, but also human welfare and economy as well. In order to address it, changes are going to have to be made, and they will have socio-economic impacts. So actually, arguably, one could say that one expects there to be socio-economic impacts of the strategy, and if they aren't there, it probably isn't working. So it remains to be seen what those impacts will be, because implementation is going to be everything. And with that previous strategy that I talked about, it was actually pretty good in our view. The problem was it just wasn't implemented. And so we have the situation where we're continuing to lose biodiversity in this country. 24% average species abundance of wildlife decline since 1994. That's a quarter since 1994, which is really hugely significant. So ongoing biodiversity decline, which we know from the State of Nature report, which was published just a few weeks ago. So socioeconomic impacts is something which I think we can expect, but they can be positive in our view.
Just before we move on, Paul, can I just pick up on one thing? Yeah. You mentioned the engagement maybe wasn't there at the start of the process, but it has improved. So do you think it's now fixed, or is there still more that the government can do to improve that engagement as we go through this?
Well, the delivery plan points to a governance structure that involves a strategic biodiversity council, but it's not actually clear who's going to be on it. And there's another body which is proposed, which is an operational delivery board. And what it seems to be is that non-government actors, non-government delivery partners will be part of the operational delivery board, but not the strategic biodiversity council. I may be wrong in that, but that's our reading of it. We actually think it would be much better to have non-government representatives, senior representatives, on that strategic biodiversity council, so that we can make sure that our organisational priorities and government's priorities for biodiversity align in the same places to do the same actions, that we agree the same ecosystems and species are the priorities for Scotland. And that's partly underway. So one thing that's been really good is a Species at Risk initiative that Nature Scot are running, which has been very collegiate, and we are agreeing amongst, you know, a cross-sectoral group what are the species that most need conservation in Scotland. So on species, we're doing quite well. I think there's a bit way to go in more general governance, but NGO membership and wider non-government membership of the Strategic Biodiversity Council is a way that could be fixed.
Okay, thank you. Bruce?
Taking your point, I will just agree with everything that Paul said, but also on the engagement front, I think there's two things, as Sarah highlighted. There's the kind of like member engagement. So I think beyond the policy level staff within RSPB, NFUS, Scottish Wildlife Trust and others, this has had very little filter through to the general public. And I think that's something we really need to address. And we've seen this in things like HPMAs and everything. We need to get better at that direct engagement. And I completely agree with Sarah that the timeframes to deal with this, I can't remember how long it ended up being, 105-page consultation, that our response ran to over 65 pages in you know, trying to get back to government on. And I'd be amazed if anyone within the government has got enough time to read all this, but we felt like we really needed to get it down and make our points. We need to get better at condensing some of these things and getting public feedback in it. And it engagement, certainly from our perspective, as Paul says, it definitely did improve. And you know, specifically, I want to mention Sue Hanson at Nature Scot, put in a load of work trying to get feedback from a whole range of different stakeholders, and really compiling that into the final document that we saw. The difference that I've seen with something like the agricultural process is we've seen quite a structured way for people from industry to feed into the development of what we've now seen as the initial bill. We didn't really have the same when we've been producing this biodiversity framework work, which includes the Natural Environment Bill, and I'd like to move towards that and agree with what Paul says. I think NGOs and other delivery partners need to be on that oversight board. On your question about socio-economic impacts, impacts go both ways, so we also need to be aware of the massive potential benefits of investing in biodiversity. At a lower end, the estimate is that you get about £1.35 return on investment. At the higher end, it's about £15 return on investment for investments in the natural world. So as well as potential socioeconomic negative impacts, you know, that might be cost to businesses in the short term, we need to look at the long-term benefits. The primary benefit being the continuation of life on Earth. I know it seems a little bit like I might be overstating things here, but Paul is right. The IPBES report is not glowing. We're 25th from the bottom on the Biodiversity Intactness Index. We need to turn these things around, and we need to bear that in mind. Crucial to this, we need to see the biodiversity investment plan that is promised in this document, but I really want to see a time frame for that. And within the consultation document itself, I was slightly worried that seemed to make reference to that only being about the kind of use of the Nature Restoration Fund, which is public money that Nature Scot administers and uses for projects. A biodiversity investment plan, to my mind, needs to include the whole range of potential funding sources so we can be aware of where those might come from and see how they might play their part, because the Scottish Government signals quite strongly that they want to see a range of sources pay for some of the actions that are in this plan.
Thank you. And Ilse, anything to add?
Ilse, you're muted at the moment.
To contribute today. I think Ilse, I would pick up on some of the points Sorry, can you hear me okay?
We can now, but we missed the very first part, and I would hate if you didn't get your most salient point across. Do you want to start again?
No, Always takes me about a minute to get to the salient point, so you're fine. No, thanks for the opportunity to contribute today. No, I just really wanted to pick up on some of the points that Bruce had made there around that element of direct engagement, and certainly from a sort of community landowner's perspective, we haven't had any detailed engagement on either the strategy or the delivery plan. I can't really speak for wider community engagement, but as far as I'm aware, that hasn't happened. And of course, so much of the success of the delivery of the strategy will be done at a local level. So I think there's quite a bit of work to be done around the thinking of how that could happen and will be successful. So I really appreciate the opportunity to input further at either that strategic board level or at other levels in terms of delivery. I think there's lots of great examples of how community organisations are delivering on habitat and species work at a local level. I'm really happy to talk about some of those today. So there are mechanisms that do work and that do exist. I think they need to be highlighted in any delivery strategy because, again, coming to your second point, they do address some of those socioeconomic impacts that Douglas Rumsden mentioned there and that others have mentioned in terms of getting that balance right between ensuring that we protect and enhance Scotland's biodiversity, but the local socio and economic impacts can also be maximised. So we know that obviously Scottish Government have a number of priorities around community wealth building and land reform and community empowerment, and I think getting the balance between all of those will be really critical, and the delivery plan at the moment doesn't necessarily look in detail of how that can be delivered, but there are mechanisms, as I say, for doing that, so it'll be interesting to have the opportunity to talk about what some of those mechanisms are and how they can be scaled up within the resources that we have available. Thank you.
Douglas, just before you go on to the next question, I'm just concerned, and I'll float this out here to start with, after the first question, which took quite a lot of time to get all your answers in, I'm working out that we've got 3 hours worth of answers to come back, and we don't have 3 hours worth of time, so I am going to push you continually during the meeting to be as brief as possible, and I've started off 2024 on a sharp note on that. Douglas.
I'm sure the first question always takes the longest convener. Next question I had was around when we heard from the marine stakeholders, there was mixed views that many of the targets and actions were not smart. And that the plan lacks significant new commitments in light of government's commitment to a step change. So I guess the question for you is, are there significant new commitments in the plan relating to terrestrial biodiversity, and does it set out smart targets? I don't know who wants to, maybe Sarah this time?
Sure. So I would completely agree with the witnesses in the marine session in that the plans are not smart. We actually think there is a lot of detail that is missing in this delivery plan. How will they be smart? How will they work in practice? What will they actually mean for active farming businesses? There's also missing detail around what funding will be allocated to each action and from which budget, who's responsible for leading on each action to ensure it's achieved. Timelines, it's not just about an end date, it's about the pathway of how we get there, and how, crucially as well, how policies will tie in with other policies, strategies and commitments, not least the Ag Bill, but you know, other kind of legislation and strategies and policies coming down the line. So yeah, we would completely echo what has been said before in that there is a lack of detail in there, and you know, in terms of whether that's going to create a step change, we really struggle to see how a change is going to be made without that detail. You know, when we are engaging our farmers, when we are engaging our members, the main thing they want to know is, what will this mean for me? How will this affect how I farm? And we don't feel like that detail is there. And I really struggle to understand how we can, you know, make the change that is needed to be made in terms of addressing biodiversity loss and in restoring nature without that detail.
Paul, can I maybe come to you on that same question? Because you mentioned the last strategy maybe not having the sort of smart target set.
I agree with what Sarah said. You are going to get this as a uniform response, and I think Nature Scot are aware that there's a lack of smart targets. There is too much, in our view, reference to let's have another plan, let's have another strategy, let's develop another strategy, which is simply too vague. There's no real specifics that people can actually work with. There's a lack of a spatial element to the delivery plan. So it's not really clear what the priorities are and where in which parts of Scotland are going to be important for which ecosystems and which species, which is an exercise that needs to be undertaken. It can be done quite quickly. We know this. It's known across the sector. So we think this can be done quickly, but it needs to be done quite urgently. And I think, again, we're hitting this issue of an effort being made to mainstream biodiversity across government and it being quite problematic to get other bits of government that aren't involved directly in biodiversity at the moment involved in that. But the great hope for mainstreaming must be the legally binding targets for nature, which are signalled in for the Natural Environment Bill, which is due later this year, which is a real opportunity to mainstream biodiversity across government and actually develop some of those specifics. But from our point of view, the delivery plan does look rather like what the strategy should be, and the delivery plan, the real meat of the detail, which to be honest, was the Minister did say would be in the delivery plan in the response to the letter from the committee back in September or October. We actually think it isn't quite there yet.
Okay. Anyone else like to add in? Caroline?
Example, you asked a question about whether there are new commitments in here, and it's very hard to judge that because the delivery plan does not map itself onto existing actions in a coherent or consistent way. So just to give you one example, there is mention in here about soils and new guidance for developers about protection of soils, and the RTPI supports that, but it is also already a policy in National Planning Framework 4. So it's policy number 5, I believe, on soils. So the question is the action in the delivery plan additional to the work that should be happening around policy 5 and NPF 4, or is it the same thing? So it's hard to judge, and particularly as a as someone coming with knowledge about certain parts of this work and this world, looking at it across the board, I know that there are some things in here which are already happening and have already been delivered. There are some things that have been published already that are in this action plan. So it's very hard because the delivery plan itself does not map what's existing and what's new. And it should do, I think. Okay. We think, yeah.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in on? Bruce?
I would like to agree with all that. I'd also think there is a real place to go through after mapping out what is new commitment and what's already existing commitment, and work out all this into account, does this take us to where we need to be for basically the 2030 target of reversing declines? It's not apparent from that list of actions if that has been carried out and we know that we're going to get to a place where we've reversed declines. I think I'll leave it there in the interest of time.
Thank you. And I'll go on to my last question then, Convener. It's been mentioned already in terms of mainstreaming. So the People's Plan for Nature calls for more mainstreaming of nature into decision making, more leadership and more government accountability. So does the draft delivery plan provide for more mainstreaming of biodiversity, and what would successful mainstreaming look like? And we want to pick up on that. Bruce?
It does kind of relate to your last question in that the delivery organisations are not easily identifiable, mapped against the actions. So it's hard to say who would be taking a lead, who would be engaging on those specific topics. So it's very difficult to say if it's been properly mainstreamed. And because it's difficult to say, I suspect that we have got a real uphill struggle to try and mainstream this stuff across government. When I look at the SMART targets, if we take the example of agriculture, it looks like a lot of the stuff that's in the Scottish Government's vision for agriculture statement has just been mapped across into these actions, which doesn't suggest there's been a back and forth dialogue between colleagues on the biodiversity side of the house and agriculture colleagues. It looks like the environment side of things has just taken the environmental ambitions within the existing strategy, so I'd question if it's had much of an impact on that.
So in terms of mainstreaming, you still think there's a good way to go?
Certainly.
Okay. Paul?
I would just like to make one point that I think is quite important, that This delivery plan is part of a huge biodiversity framework that goes well beyond it. It was a massive consultation that ended in December. It's not all bad. And there's some bits of the delivery plan which are really quite specific. And I'm thinking about deer, for example. The deer bit is very specific about numbers, about, broadly speaking, where this needs to happen, and it's ambitious. And we really, really welcome it. I mean, the difficulty is in that mainstreaming, and I think it is a very, very challenging thing to achieve, because biodiversity has been completely siloed to date. It's been seen as a very specialist thing that a little branch of government does alongside SNH / Nature Scot, and we can sort of leave it to that. But it really needs to be integrated. And most of Scotland is farmed. It has to integrate with agricultural policy. But as Bruce said, what we've got in the delivery plan is basically a rehash of what is already committed to or is about to be committed to. And that is a problem. It's not going to deliver added value.
OK, thank you.
On to the next questions. I'm sorry, I've got to be quite tight on them. Jackie, the next questions come from you.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Would it be helpful if I just asked people to raise their hands if they want to answer my question?
Yes, I'm getting the feeling from this panel they'll all raise your hands, but you can certainly try if you want to.
Okay, grand. Good morning, panel. Thank you very much for coming along. The objective of the draft strategy is to accelerate the restoration and regeneration of the ecosystem. Do you think that the draft plan sets out a clear, prioritised pathway through, when you look through the key actions, does it provide that? And what do you think actually needs to happen on the ground to support the delivery? Bruce, I'm going to go to you because you've caught my eye.
I do think there is a prioritisation exercise to be done. If you were to look at this from the perspective of someone on the ground, so within a local authority, if we take the nature networks element of this, I would find it very difficult to know what had to be done by when, what my kind of duties were around reporting. Was this more important than my responsibilities around deer management? It would be very hard for me to interpret that. So I think there needs to be the prioritisation, and I understand why that has been very difficult to do, because the time frames in which this has been developed, and Paul says it's not by any means all bad. I want to really support the overall ambition here. We're just trying to help with suggestions, and one major improvement that could be made is that prioritisation, and second of all, providing appropriate guidance for the relevant delivery partners so they can help work out what has to be done and by when.
Ilsa, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I think it would be interesting for communities to have a much clearer idea of that prioritisation, and as Bruce has just said there, how that can be delivered, because we know from our membership that there's a huge interest in getting more engaged in this, and those local people that are at the very sharp end of habitat and species loss really do want to get engaged. But at the moment, as we said in the first question, there hasn't been much consultation and engagement at a local level, so opportunities within the delivery plan to really focus on how community-led action can contribute would be very helpful.
Okay, thank you. Caroline and then Sarah.
Thanks. Yes, just on this mainstreaming, I think National Planning Framework number 4 has done a very good job of mainstreaming biodiversity and the nature crisis into the planning system, and that's very, very clear in policy one. But I think this is where this plan doesn't interact with that in a coherent or consistent way. So, for example, there are questions about local place plans, local development plans. Should they be doing more? What should they be doing? And how does this delivery plan interact with the guidance that's emerging around the preparation of those types of strategies, so that planning can help it and do its part in relation to protecting existing biodiversity and enhancing, providing for those spatial networks, the nature networks and the 30 by 30 protections, but also this creating, building, where should we put new nature, where should we build biodiversity? And I think there are questions about that many of our members and practitioners are wanting answers to, and this doesn't help. So that spatial side of things, but also the timeline. What are the priorities? Where do interventions need to be happening and who needs to be doing it. So going back to the SMART objectives and that need for that extra level of detail around the actions, who's leading, when are they doing it, what's the timeline, what's the priority, and where are the resources?
And do you think the planning needs more power to their elbow when it comes to that?
Definitely, and they certainly need more funding and resource. We published an assessment of resourcing in the planning system just in December, and the number of local authority planners in Scotland is the lowest it's been for 5 years, and we know budgets are being cut, and at the same time we have extra duties under the Planning Act and NPF 4. So biodiversity on top of that is very hard in a sector which is really under pressure. And we know there's a skills issue. Our members are, they know about biodiversity net gain
from England.
I'm going
to stop here because I asked if it was power to the elbow, and we have heard from,
skills,
previously.
Yeah.
I'm sorry if I sound rude, but I'm trying to get everybody in. Sarah, would you like to?
So we'd completely agree that prioritisation exercise is needed and it needs to go a lot further. But I think it's also important to say that it shouldn't be prescriptive. And in terms of nature restoration, we almost think that there should be kind of two kind of elements to it. And when it comes to farming and crofting, every farm is going to have potential to deliver for climate and deliver for nature, but what each farm does could be different. And so we want farmers to be empowered and to have the ability to choose what is right for their farm. And that's an important part of designing this action plan and designing measures within the agricultural bill as well. Every farmer should be able to play its part, but what that is may differ. On the landscape scale, on a kind of catchment scale, we do need to have that wider picture of ensuring that there's not knock-on impacts or unintended consequences. So you almost need that kind of dual level of what's right for the individual farm, but also what's happening at that kind of wider holistic scale. And I do think that's missing. We do need more of a strategic, you know, land use planning in Scotland to ensure that that is the case. And I think it's also important to mention when we talk about, you know, taking action and moving forward, that farmers are already doing really good things. There's a lot of work in this area that's already been done. We're not starting from zero. There's a lot of work that's been done out there. So it's more about encouraging, empowering, inspiring people to kind of go further in that sense. And just slightly, if I can, on the mainstreaming point as well, I think because it ties into this question, is that it really shows the need that it's not just farmers and crofters that are responsible for solving this issue. It does require a whole society approach. We need local authorities, we need members of the public, we need other bodies to play a part in this as well. So I think that also plays into the importance of a kind of landscape, holistic scale approach.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go on to the next question, but I'm going to be fair and come to Paul first, if that's okay. So, Paul, if you would like to just add anything in of that you really want to get in for the first question, then please feel free. The plan highlights the progress that's already been made with woodland and peatland restoration programmes, but we know that there's still challenges in meeting those targets and spending the committed budgets in this area. What needs to happen in the coming 5 years to accelerate the progress of this so that we can get things going?
Do you mean for peatland specifically, or do you mean across the board for biodiversity?
Well, woodland, peatland, but if you'd like to answer for across the board, then
yeah. Well, I mean, I think this relates to your first question. So biodiversity comprises species, and the species come together to form ecosystems, which are dynamic living systems. And all of those in Scotland have some sort of human element, and indeed some of them are made by farming. Macher grasslands in the Western Isles, for example. So it's profoundly linked through to our society and to our economy. The plan signals a programme of ecosystem restoration and then a programme of species recovery for those species that need the targeted individual action. And that is something we called for right from the start. And it was included fairly late in the process, and therefore we have it's just mentioned in the strategy. We'll have this. And I think there's a list of ecosystems that's a footnote in one of the pages. So it's not really properly developed. As the other panel members have said, it really needs a lot more thinking around what's specific. And I think that needs to be geographically specific, which I think would work to Sarah's point about farmers and crofts of different parts of Scotland need to know what they can deliver and to input to that process. So I think there's real scope
dependent
for that.
Dependent on where they live, is that what you mean?
Absolutely, yeah. So different parts of Scotland. So, you couldn't have a macker programme in the east coast of Scotland because you don't get macker in the east coast of Scotland, as one example. And it's the same for all other ecosystems. We need broadly to figure out what the priorities are where. And that's the one thing we're looking for from this delivery plan. And that's what we're not really, what we haven't really got yet. But I do think we're on the way. And I just want to underscore that there's opportunities here for society, for economy. So the government has multiple initiatives established at the moment for training. But those could really work to deliver biodiversity. We could have training for land management advisors who help farmers and crofters to do the right thing for the priorities in their area. We could have training for new deer stalkers, so the money that's spent on fencing woodland is instead put into actual young people training as high welfare standard deer stalkers. Ecosystem restoration contractors, invasive non-native species control contractors and experts, biodiversity monitoring. This could all be integrated into a government training programme and really help to deliver this stuff and deliver those green jobs that the country so badly needs, particularly in rural areas. So I think there's great scope here, but it's just not quite signalled in the delivery plan yet.
Okay. So what I'm hearing from you is you would like to see geographic being rather than key, well, as well as, sorry, not rather than key sectors and groups to be all added in.
The two automatically go hand in hand. Okay. This is a very varied country. Yeah.
Grand, thank you. And everybody's agreeing with that comment, convener. Would anybody else like to add anything in? And because I think Paul's just answered my third question as well.
Sorry?
I think Paul just went and answered my third question.
So you're
as
happy
well.
You've had your
I'm
question.
Happy because I know that you're going to come in with a few supplementaries, aren't you?
Well, I've just got one broad supplementary. Is you talk about targets and achieving, and you've talked about zoning, and I understand that. But we've had woodland targets that since 2018, not one of them has been met by the government. In fact, we have only reached 80% if you top them all up. And if you top them all up, before they adjusted the targets downwards, they probably only reached about 65% of all the woodland that should have been created in Scotland. And we've just seen in the budget a 45% cut in woodland grant scheme monies. So we also know that when it comes to peatland, we're not spending the money that we need to spend on peatland because we can't get the contractors to do the work. So not enough money, not enough contractors, great ambitions, but no delivery. Sarah, how are we going to come around that?
I think everything that you've said is absolutely correct, and I think a lot of our members, in fact, most all of our members would agree with that. I think tree planting peatland are really good examples where there is those nationwide targets, and that's ambition and that's good. But I think, at risk of repeating myself, what I've said about it's for individual farms to decide what is relevant and what's appropriate for their individual farms. And I think a large part of what is missing from this plan and what is missing from land use decisions in Scotland generally is the where. We can have targets, but where are they going to be? And what knock-on impacts will they have? And, I think we do need to move past farming versus forestry. It's a debate that's been rumbling on for quite some time, but we do have difficult questions that need answered, and I suppose that plays into the socio-economic impact side of things. There will be changes, and there will be changes to land use in Scotland that because of these difficult decisions, but we have to be conscious of that. I think another reason why maybe we're not meeting these targets and going forward as we would like is uncertainty around certain policies. We have got many different things coming down the line. We've got a new agricultural bill that's going to be in place in the next few years. Perhaps people are waiting to see what that's going to look like in full before making decisions. I think, asking people to do something before all the detail is realised is there's a lot of risk there. And I think when it comes to funding and when it comes to the grant schemes, those could be better for a start. I think there needs to be more de-risking of these activities for farmers and crofters so that they're incentivised, I suppose, to take up those those activities. So I suppose that's kind of a roundabout way of saying that, yeah, we do need all of these things. We need the funding, we need appropriate grant schemes, we need incentives, but we also need certainty in terms of policy clarity and policy detail as well.
Okay, so Paul, RSPB, big landowners in Scotland, huge tracts of land. Do they need it de-risking to do the right thing, or are they going to get on and do it and create more woodlands on some of their reserves?
Yeah, we're really actively involved with that, and not just on our reserves, but beyond our reserves as well. So, for example, we've got a project in Morvern, which is about re-establishing Scotland's rainforest on the entire peninsula. And we do that, we're focusing on the peninsula because it's ecologically defendable, so you can clear rhododendron and you've got a good chance to secure biosecurity. But you talk about targets, convener. We've had biodiversity targets since 1992, and we have failed to meet all of them. So the failure to meet targets is very, very familiar for people in our sector, and I guess this is what we're talking about in terms of mainstreaming and in terms of integration of these targets. There's a bit of a rush at the moment, actually, to secure planting and harvesting targets for trees, which is leading to an intensification of forestry practice, and sometimes we fear wrong tree in the wrong place, so actually may have negative outcomes for biodiversity. So and of course we have plantations in ancient woodland which needs to be treated, so ancient woodlands aren't entirely protected. So there's a huge way to go, and that is why we keep coming back to this kind of mainstream point, which is until this becomes a sort of widely recognised political imperative across all bits of government, including agriculture, forestry, marine, etc., we aren't really going to have a meaningful biodiversity strategy that can meet these targets. Biodiversity is extremely complex, extremely far-reaching, and really touches people's lives when you're talking about the way land is managed. It affects businesses, it affects industries, and that is the challenge, and that's a challenge, frankly, we haven't managed to meet yet. I'm not saying it's easy, but there's a way to go still with this delivery plan, I think.
Bruce, I'll bring you in very briefly, but it seems to me that both of you are saying that whilst we haven't reached the targets, maybe the old scheme of local biodiversity action plans, if they'd been properly implemented, might have been the way forward. Bruce?
I think there's definitely an important place for BAPs, very important tool. When we're talking about the targets, though, at a kind of national level, I think a step change that we've seen is this move to put climate and nature on the same pedestal. And I think previously there has been some mistakes made. So, for example, in a rush to plant a certain type of tree just to meet carbon targets without considering biodiversity impacts. And it's difficult, it's going to be much harder, but we need to consider both. Otherwise, we're not going to do it properly, and we're not going to meet our long-term targets.
Thank you, and I'm sure somewhere in there we'll consider what we're going to eat as well. So the next questions come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Thanks very much, Convener. So I was going to ask about the meeting of the 30 by 30 target, that big international, overreaching target, whether there's enough clarity in the strategy about the pathway to meeting that. But I was just reflecting on some of your answers earlier on, and I suppose to kind of summarise what I'm hearing is, the NGOs on the panel don't feel there's enough detail within this strategy. So we've got a high-level strategy, we've got a high-level delivery plan, but the detail is really lacking. But then I also heard from yourself, Sarah, that your members feel that, that we can't be too prescriptive at this point as well. So in terms of delivery of that 30 by 30, what do you think is needed, and is there enough of that within the delivery plan at the moment to give that certainty? Do you want to start, Sarah?
So I think to answer your question about is the 30 by 30 target clear, I don't think it is at all. I think the framework that's in the biodiversity in this consultation in the form it wasn't clear at all what that would actually mean. It's not clear where that 30% will be, and if there is a proportion of that on farmland, what that will mean for farmers and crofters, how it will impact active farming. So I think that's a very brief response in that no, it's not clear. In terms of what is needed, I I can understand that this may be contradictory, but I think we do need stronger definitions, but we don't want it to be too prescriptive. So we maybe need stronger definitions around even things like protect, restore. What is that going to mean for a farmer in practice? But, you know, on that flip side, as I've mentioned, we don't want it to be too prescriptive that you have to do a certain thing and you have to meet a certain target. I think, you know, what we're hearing more and more is that biodiversity in nature is so complex, and what we want to focus on more is the actions rather than necessarily the outcomes. A farmer, a crofter, whoever can do all the right things. If there's evidence there that creating a certain habitat provides a certain species, of course, that's what should be supported. But with all the will in the world, that may not lead to biodiversity increase, or it may not lead to a specific species increasing on that land. And we don't think that that should be, you know, a punitive measure. That shouldn't be punished, that it should be rewarded if you're doing the actions that are right. So it's sort of, a dual approach there. We need more clarity on what that 30 by 30 means, what it's going to mean for farmers, but at the same time, it shouldn't be rigid, it shouldn't be prescriptive, it should be flexible enough for farmers to be empowered to choose what's right for their farm. So I think much more detail on that.
Yeah, but isn't the danger there, Sarah, that actually nothing happens as a result of that? So at the end of the day, somebody needs to look at a particular area, be it Cairngorms or Fife or whatever particular catchment, and somebody on the ground needs to make decisions about what they're going to invest in.
Absolutely.
And what are those targets? So how do you meet 30 by 30 on the ground to the satisfaction of your members, to give them the clarity without being too prescriptive about what they need to be investing in?
Well, I think that's why you need the holistic landscape scale view of things. You know, who's doing what in this landscape, and is it meeting the broader picture? And then at an individual level, people are doing what's best for their farm. It's never going to be perfect. Nature is not perfect, and biodiversity is complex by its nature. So, you know, saying, having prescriptive targets and, you know, getting every farm to put X amount of their land aside, that may not be suitable for every farm. So it's about getting the individual to do what's right for them. I don't agree with the fact that that means nothing will change and that we'll have the status quo, because people are already doing good things for nature, whether that's in the west with our less favoured areas. They're, you know, undertaking traditional grazing management and good farming techniques. In the west, we've got our combinable crops and our arable farmers who are doing good things around integrated pest management. Things are already underway, and I don't think that you know, we're going to go backwards or we're going to just stall because we're we're not setting down prescriptive outcomes. Things are moving forward, and what we need to make clear as well is that when farmers undertake these actions that are good for nature, they're also good for the business, they're good for climate, they're good for rural communities. So highlighting those kind of combined benefits is a positive. So I don't think things are just going to stay the same. Farmers know that things are changing, and we are moving forward.
Who else would like to come in? So this is about 30-30. How do we actually deliver on the ground, Paul?
Just to say that there are positive things happening on the ground, but we are still losing nature at a completely unacceptable rate. We know this from the State of Nature report. Species and habitat loss continues, and the majority of Scotland is farmed. So there's an undoubtable link, and a level of prescription is completely unavoidable. I'm afraid it's going to be needed if we're going to make the kind of progress which is about halting biodiversity loss. On 30 by 30, I'm really glad that you signal this as being a global initiative. This is a global initiative of which Scotland is just one part. But I do think there's some hope for the kind of approach you're calling for, Sarah, in terms of current protected areas. The first point I want to make is it does not mean an end to all human activity in those areas. Indeed, some of them, like the Macker special protection areas, special areas of conservation I was talking about earlier, the definition of Macker has agriculture right front and centre in there. And without those extensive cattle-based crofting systems, there would be no Macker. And we have 70% of the world complement of Macker in Scotland. So it's a really, really significant thing. So protected areas allow forestry and allow farming to continue as long as it doesn't damage the features for which that area is designated. But there's another approach which is going to be brought in with 30 by 30, which is what they call OECMs, which is other effective land-based conservation measures. And these can be different. So these can involve much more engagement with communities, with land managers on the ground in terms of where they are designated, how they are designated, and what the important features will be. They can't be weaker in terms of the delivery of biodiversity. And I do think delivery of real species, real habitats, progress is what is required by this delivery plan. It's not just, oh, we can do some stuff that looks good and then that will tick the box. I don't think it does that. We do need to actually halt biodiversity loss, but we can do it with a more creative way of approaching the 30 by 30 target, which I think is signalled in the biodiversity framework, actually. I think that's quite encouraging, and I look forward to seeing how these OECMs are developed and how much they can contribute towards that. Scotland's playing its part in the Global 30 by 30 initiative.
All that detail, are you saying, Paul, that you would expect to see that in this delivery plan, or are there actually other plans, be them regional or species specific, that should come out of this that provides that clarity?
It feels
like you want to see everything in the plan, every action, every target, everything right now, and I'm just wondering what is the level that's appropriate to see within this plan at this point. But
I mean, the point that Sarah made about the land use strategy, I mean, that was an initiative that kind of stalled, but it was a really positive move forward in our view, and I think across the Link NGOs, in terms of what's important where, how we can combine the imperative for food security, the imperative for planting, for carbon offsetting, and the priorities for biodiversity. It was a real opportunity to do that, and I do think, I would agree with NFUS that's something we need to revisit.
Okay. Bruce, Caroline, Elsa, do you want to come in on this?
I agree with all that. We really, really need to get on top of this plethora of land use planning tools. So we've got local nature networks, an aspiration for a kind of national nature network, regional land use partnerships, the overall land use strategy, river basin management plans. Something needs to bring these all together. I suggest a sort of national ecological network setting priorities, or a national nature network would really help here, and then you can get the bottom up helping to deliver that. That's something that I think needs to happen. It's pretty obvious, I think, that with 30 by 30 in the title, we're at the start of 2024, there is not a lot of time to do this. So the urgency thing really can't be understated. I know that presents problems, but we really need to get on and do this and set up the governance structures so that we can understand how this is going to be rolled out.
Caroline, you want to come in. Could I just ask, just as a supplementary, as part of that, do you want to see that map-based or just all in documents? Caroline?
I think map-based would be fantastic. But, you know, because then we can move into the digital side of things where you can, you know, do that sort of sieve mapping and looking at where opportunities for interventions might be. And, yeah, we get a better sense of where these things might be happening. I just agree, you know, we need all of these things to line up, and of course I would also add in local place plans and development plans and green infrastructure strategies and open space strategies and all of those other things which also intersect and interface with this biodiversity work.
While we're drawing lines on a map, can I also raise the topic of national parks as well briefly? I'd like to get your reflections on the designation for at least one new national park, how that can contribute to these targets, and also, you know, your reflections on how national parks are working at the moment. Are they actually delivering effectively for this agenda? And if not, what needs to change? So, you know, brief reflections on that would be useful. Elsa, I don't know if you'd like to come in on this, or we could go to other panel members.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, no, thank you. Just very briefly. Again, I think there's some really good examples of work in Cairngorm and Loch Lomond where communities are being engaged at a very local level in terms of how they can contribute to this agenda. And there are small pots of money which the local, which the national park authorities are investing in enabling them to do that. So I think if there was to be a third national park, then the lessons of what's worked needs to be transferred over to that to ensure that local people can have some meaningful engagement and intervention in this, rather than, as we talked about at the very beginning, being the last people to be considered. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. Anyone else?
Yeah. I've been in that briefly. So Our position on national parks is clear. We believe that food production and farming is integral to Scotland's rural economy, and that shouldn't be forgotten or ignored. In fact, it should be central to existing and any new national parks. Many of our members don't feel the two existing national parks have made a positive contribution for farming, and are therefore sceptical about the creation of new ones. However, we do realise that this is a policy that is being pursued, and that we are likely to see a new national park. So we want to see meaningful and positive local engagement with the local community, not just specific sectors, but all sectors, to ensure that there is success going forward.
And we would like to see national parks delivering better for nature. I think, as Ailsa said, there have been some great examples of really positive action and really positive community engagement in Cairngorms and in Loch Lomond. But it is not entirely what we would expect of a national park, and we do think that the restoration of ecosystems really has to be given serious priority in national parks. I think that's what people expect. I think it's what the public expect. Let's not forget that Wild Isles series, in which Scotland really was the star on TV. 10.7 million viewers it attracted. This is a big, quite a big deal for the public in terms of national mental well-being, I would actually argue. I think our national parks really need to deliver for that. And I just want to just touch on this mapping point. I totally agree that mapping is the approach to this kind of spatial element that we need to this. But just a plea that it doesn't... It's not a new five-year mapping exercise that's undertaken, because it could so easily swallow up so much time. We need to find a really streamlined route to actually putting down on paper what we know already, because we know it. That's just a plea.
Yep. I mean, the maps exist, basically. Yeah, you know, like they're ready to be rolled out. I think it's just I hear so much agreement around the room that this is the way forward. It would be nice to see that. Yeah. There's also a proposal in here for 6 priority woodland areas, I think, between 10 and 50,000 hectares. And,
sorry, is this a national park?
Sorry, within the right. frameworks. And it's interesting to see the comparison, people I've talked to, the pros and cons from a community perspective of those areas, which would probably focus on deer management with the woodland element versus the designation for a national park. So we've purposely taken the decision to not put forward areas for consideration on national parks, because we think that really has to be from communities in order for them to be successful.
Yeah. Caroline, any thoughts on?
We don't have a strong position on the the extra national park.
Okay. I know, Bob, you're wanting to go in on Nature Network. Do you want to go on Nature Networks? We've both got an interest in Nature Networks, and I suppose you've touched already a little bit on that. I mean, Bruce, I'll maybe come to you first then as to how you see this rolling out, because the responsibility is very much for local councils to develop this. I'm wondering, though, do councils actually have all the powers and tools to be able to do that? And I think your own organisation was pushing initially for a big overarching national network rather than 32 local networks. Where do you think the state of play is in terms of nature networks being the real driver for
so delivery? Yeah, I mean, in the sands of time, Scottish Wildlife Trust was really pushing, and others, RSPB and Scottish Environment Link, for a sort of national approach, not in any way completely top down, but helping to provide that prioritisation that we've talked about for nature, because it's so important. There was commitments to that in previous strategies and planning frameworks, and it's never happened. So we're at a stage now that I think it will happen. It's just taken 10 years to get to this stage. The top down is very important for allowing a kind of overview to let people know what those priorities are. We're completely supportive of that being delivered from the bottom up. The reason that we think we need overall spatial strategy is just this analogy that I've used a lot of times with a broadband network or a road network. We would not just start putting in cable or roundabouts and roads and expect a coherent network. Well, it's exactly the same with nature. We have to strategically plan where this stuff is if we want to see the ecosystem restoration, but also the benefits that provides to us as well. So, you know, pollinators, we can't just have the odd little patch of habitat here and there. It needs to be a coherent network so that they can move around, have interactions that we'd expect as species. So we think that overall strategic approach is very important. Your question as to whether the local authorities are equipped to deliver that, well, it's going to be very difficult. There is patchy coverage of biodiversity expertise within local authorities, so that is very important to deliver that. Funding is going to be a colossal issue. And we also have this lack of guidance currently still around the nature networks, and that's delivered. Now, that's hugely improved. There's been massive step forward within that, with what's been put forward within this document. I think we'll get there. The problem is the requirement from National Planning Framework 4 is these things are delivered through local development plans. If you were having to produce a local development plan in the near future, I think you would be sort of scratching your head as to what you have to do, what a nature network looks like. And the big fear is that the temptation would just be to do a very simple map of all the green blobs in your area and sort of say, well, that's vaguely a nature network. And that's not what it's designed to do. It's designed to interact with the 30 by 30 network to deliver this large-scale ecosystem restoration.
Thanks, Mark. I'll probably be talking some of the blobs in the local area now, Bruce. To be honest, so we know local authorities are tasked with expanding enhancing nature networks by 2030. There's specific commitment for urban areas, which is obviously of interest to me, is the MSP for Glasgow, Maryhill and Springburn. I note that Glasgow is seeking to designate a further 250 hectares within the city's nature reserves. I picked two areas in particular, because of my constituency, at Hamilton Hill Clay Pits, which has been transformational actually for the local area, but also been in partnership with wider urban regeneration, which I think is something I want to raise with you, but also at Cadder Woods, also in the Forth and Clyde Canal, which was a dumping ground for old cars and fly tipping, which actually has a real biodiversity and merit, as well as being a real asset potentially for the local community. So I suppose what I want to ask is whether witnesses believe, and probably Bruce Wilkes and Dr Brown might be best placed to respond to some of this, nature network commitment can be a dual purpose about boosting biodiversity in the way that Mr Wilson was talking about, but also to enhance the local environment for communities. So it's not about nature's over there, but it's about corridors for communities to enjoy that environment. So how do we achieve that dual purpose within what we're looking at currently? But I suppose more importantly, how can we actually monitor it to make sure it just delivers it and it's not the blobs on the map, I suppose, that Mr Wilson was talking about?
So there's two things there. There absolutely is the potential for nature networks to do that, and we've always advocated an opportunity mapping based approach, which is GIS tools to work out where your biodiverse green spaces are, how you can link them up, but what are the opportunities to link them up in the easiest way, but also providing multiple benefits. And there has been a tool developed through the Scottish Government's work on CivTech, which is an AECOM have developed a tool where you can map all this stuff and you can look at how it affects different communities where biodiverse green spaces is best to situate. So that is all achievable, and it's absolutely the way we need to go, particularly in an era of such constrained spending, getting multiple benefits, really delivering. And biodiversity has the answer to so many of the problems that we're trying to face. The health and well-being benefits of being close to biodiverse green space have been repeatedly brought forward, but they are very difficult to monitor. And that's the second part of kind of everything that we're trying to achieve here. The biodiversity data availability at the moment is just very, very poor. And we need to invest in that. And we don't just need to invest in that so that we can tell how many butterflies are in a given area. We need to invest in that so that we've got the tools to develop this green economy. We can't have positive effects of biodiversity from a new development, which is the wording from the National Planning Framework, if we don't know what the baseline biodiversity data for that site is. If we don't, you know, you mentioned the site on the Forth and Clyde Canal, we need to know baselines and we need to know what the improvements are and what those are delivering for people. And those are vital tools for us to understand where we are as a nation, not just to understand our ecological position.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Brown, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I think there's something in here which is also missing in this delivery plan, which is any discussion or recognition of the excellent work that's been happening around the Central Scotland Green Network. And Glasgow and Clyde Valley is a really great example of a very good strategy built on data, looking at opportunities for interventions and leading directly to the sorts of projects that you're talking about, which are cleaning up polluted environments, providing access to nearby nature for people, providing networks for active travel and so on, providing a health benefit and hitting those multiple policy targets around climate, around resilience, around nature, health, well-being and biodiversity. And I think there's been lots of excellent work done. And one of the things that strikes me as being missing from this is a sense of learning from those previous activities and examples. So what have we learnt? What works? And how is that reflected in these actions here?
Follow-up question, convener. So, I have no idea whether what is measured in relation to this. I see Glasgow City Council has got 37 species and action plans in place. I know they're trying to expand their nature networks, but what I don't know is anyone measuring what the impact has been on biodiversity. Clearly, you would expect it to have been positive, but is anyone actually measuring it in an agreed methodology?
So my understanding is that the Central Scotland Green Network, which is the a collaboration of local authorities across the Central Belt, that's part of that activity, is to deliver and to measure the outputs of those interventions in biodiversity terms as well as other measures.
So, Dr. Brown, for not seeking to target you in relation to this, but will that be measured the same way if there's a project in Aberdeenshire or a project in Dumfries, so that we... Because if there's different methodologies used and different agreed outcomes in each area, how do we have a national strategy, and how do we report on the national plan?
Absolutely agree that we do need some recognised methodologies for doing this and consistency about the data that's used and available to the people that are doing it, whether that's a local authority or another organisation.
OK, thank you. If there's time, convener,
I'm not sure. Mark, did you want to come back in? No. OK.
To have 3 or 4 hours on this, but yeah, we don't have the time. So,
unfortunately, we are sort of what I would say 3/4 of the way through the time and probably 50% through the questions. So, there'll be a balancing act, but not meaning to cut anyone out, and especially not the deputy convener. Ben, I'm coming to you next.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for your time. And just before I ask my question, I just wanted to also emphasise the points that my colleague raised around Urban Scotland. As somebody who represents a densely urban constituency, densely populated urban constituency, I do think though the arguments and the narrative about quality of place and health and wellbeing benefits are much more compelling often than the wider targets and discussions around Montreal treaties, and all of which can be quite nebulous sometimes to people. So I think it's important that the questions around the benefits of biodiversity in urban Scotland were raised by my colleague. But going back to other issues, I want to ask some questions around Objective 3, embedding nature, positive farming, fishing and forestry. And I want to ask, do you have confidence that agriculture, forestry and other land management policies are aligned with and will support delivery of the biodiversity delivery plan? If so, why? And if not, why not? And focusing again on the questions of implementation, which were rightly raised earlier, what needs to happen in practice to ensure that agriculture, forestry and other land management sectors deliver biodiversity gains, and that there is a just transition to a more nature-friendly position in terms of farming as a mainstream? And does the current draft delivery plan support this? In terms of... I don't know who wants to go first. I thought you might, Sarah.
Yeah,
over
I can
to
pick
you.
That off. There was a lot in there, so if I miss something out, just come back to me. But basically, yes, we think that these plans can work together. We think that farming especially farming, can deliver on biodiversity. We think it has a crucial role in doing so, and in the final version of this plan will determine how well they're able to do that. What is of concern is that there are so many other policies in this sphere. It's a very busy policy, strategy, legislation landscape that we're in just now, and obviously we do have the Agricultural Bill coming through Parliament at this stage. What is going to be in the final Agricultural Bill will have an impact on the Biodiversity Delivery Plan, and vice versa, I suppose. So what our main concern is that these are kind of going at different timelines. We've got this five-year Biodiversity Delivery Plan. There's detail that's still missing from that. In the Agricultural Bill, there's a stipulation for a five-year rural support plan. And the way that that's happening, the way that the timelines that the Agricultural Bill is going through Parliament, these are going to, they're not going to be, the 5 years are not going to be the same. And so our main concern, and we don't think it's an obstacle that can't be overcome if they're running at different timelines, is that they're compatible. And I think there's a lot more work that needs to be done to ensure that that's so. I think one of the main things around making this work as well is around budgeting and the finance that's coming into the agricultural and rural economy sector. If we take the Agricultural Bill and we take the four outcomes that are within it, that's climate, nature, rural communities and food production, these are all so, so important. But we're asking so much of farmers to deliver, and it's not to say that they can, and it's not to say that they don't want to. They most definitely do, but they need to be supported in order to do so. And so for us, the funding that's coming to the sector is going to be crucial on enabling them to deliver it. We were disappointed that money has been reallocated from the sector over the past 2 years. While we have had assurances that it will be coming back, we are still disappointed that it's not been used to support the sector in the past 2 years. As well as that, we've had a multi-annual financial commitment from the UK government since 2019, but that represents a real terms cut in agriculture and rural economy support. What we need going forward and what we need to make all these plans and all these strategies work together and to allow farming to deliver is a multi-annual funding commitment from the UK government, but also from the Scottish government. We need that support to allow farmers to deliver what they can and what they should be delivering, essentially.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Walton, and I don't know if Ilse Raeburn, if you want to come in afterwards.
Agriculture, 70-odd% of Scotland, a huge amount of public money is put into support, despite recent reductions. It's still a huge budget. We, broadly speaking, believe in public money for public goods, and we see the delivery of nature and biodiversity and climate benefits as a public good for everyone in Scotland. And in our view, we do need to see a significant redistribution of funds and the way they are spent to focus much more on delivering for climate and nature. Specifically, we think Tier 1, which is the basic payment, should really account for no more than 25% of the budget, and 75% of the budget, that's 25% each on the other tiers, which is Tier 2, which is the enhanced, Tier 3, the elective, and Tier 4, the supporting services. And in there, some of the really targeted work that's required for the important ecosystems and species which should emerge from the delivery planning process. So I think without a significant shift in how we support agriculture to help farmers and crofters to deliver, and we aren't going to manage to halt biodiversity loss in this country. And I just want to say one thing, that I do think that for far too many years we have seen a lack of support for the incredibly high nature value farming in the West, and particularly on the Isles, in terms of the extensive cattle-based crofting systems, which, as I said before, deliver globally significant biodiversity benefits. It's suffering, on the one hand, from intensification, which is the big driver of biodiversity loss right across Europe, and on the other hand, abandonment. We do think these communities need the proper levels of support that reflect the public benefits that they are delivering.
Thank you. Also, Raeburn, did you want to come in?
Yeah,
thank you. Just picking up Paul's point there about support for crofting communities in particular, and the whole scale crofting system and how that's working. A great work being done now by the Crofting Commission, but enabling more of that land to be brought into the sorts of uses that will deliver these benefits is critical. And I think also the opportunity to look again at some of the subsidy mechanisms, particularly around tree planting and woodland restoration, could actually deliver against a lot of the objectives we're talking about today. But at the moment, they're very narrowly focused. So I think it comes back to the point that other colleagues have made, that this needs to be a whole systems-based approach. We need to be looking at all of that public subsidy and how we use it better to deliver these outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you. And just before I go to Mr. Wilson, and obviously my question's focused around alignment and delivery. I mean, is there anything further in terms of, I mean, there was some discussion at the beginning around engagement between government and stakeholders and coordination across government, and the challenge of that, but the welcome challenge of broadening biodiversity as a cross-government objective, either in the answers to come or later. If there's anything more that you want to follow up with the committee on that, I think that would be useful. Mr. Wilson, you were wanting to come in.
Just on the sort of the budget side of things, we aren't really used to the agriculture budget changing that much in previous years for obvious reasons, and we're going to see more and more pressure on agriculture budgets to, for want of a better word, compete with other public spending priorities. And it's essential that we are making sure and well articulating the reason that we need to maintain these budgets for the kind of the rural portfolio. And delivery on nature and climate is such a vital part of that, that we need to make sure that it's well understood that farming does at the moment, but can do much more to deliver for those huge priorities, as well as producing food as well. And there is that alignment, that alignment exercise is needed. We need to have greater read across between what we're seeing in the ambition is within the biodiversity framework that we're talking about and the agriculture vision. We think that there's probably, I'm just thinking, I'll leave that point actually, sorry. I'm probably going to talk for quite a while on that one, so I'll leave that one and save it for the next question, just bearing in mind your advice.
Thank you. Unless colleagues have any supplementaries on Objective 3, convener, I'll move to Objective 4.
That's go for it.
Appropriate. Thank you. So just moving forward on to Objective 4, which is, of course, related, which is protect and support the recovery of vulnerable and important species and habitats. What should be the priorities in developing an effective species recovery, reintroduction and reinforcement programme, and what does restoring our native wildlife look like, and are we keeping pace with the rest of Europe in the approach to species recovery and reintroductions? For example, what key lessons have we learned to date through experiences supporting the reintroduction and translocation of eagles and beavers, for example, particularly where there has been a need to manage tensions or competing land management objectives, and I think those are particularly the relocation of and reintroduction of beavers is a really interesting example of that. So I don't know who wants to come in first on that, but yeah, Dr. Walton.
In terms of species recovery, I mean, our view is pretty clear. So we need a national programme of ecosystem restoration, and by ecosystem what I mean is some quite specific things like kelp beds, species rich grassland, Scotland's rainforest, Caledonian pinewood. So these are recognisable ecosystems. It's very hard to draw an absolute line around them, but scientists know what these things are. And on those we have seen massive losses through the past sort of three centuries, actually, or and possibly more, And this is what's making Scotland one of the most nature-depleted countries in the world, and certainly among the, you know, G20 countries. But on top of that, you need targeted species recovery work for those species which won't be captured by the more general work. So, for example, you could have a programme of Caledonian pinewood restoration that does a brilliant job, and you get beautiful Caledonian pinewoods expanding. But for a species called the twin flower, which is a particular, very beautiful sort of plant that grows within that habitat, actually the stands of twin flower are too far apart now for the pollinators to move between them. And so they're actually dying out. So they require a programme of translocation to make sure that the density of stands of twin flower is sufficient for that species to continue. So that's an example where you need targeted species work. Our seabirds, 70% of our seabird species are in decline. The recent census, which was reported in December, it's really staggering and extremely worrying, because these are some of our most globally significant wildlife populations. These birds need the eradication of invasive non-native predators introduced by people so that their breeding sites are safe for them. It's as simple as that. That's an example of targeted species work that's needed on top of the ecosystem recovery in the marine environment. So I want it to be absolutely clear that these two things are absolutely essential. In terms of ecosystem recovery programmes, there's insufficient detail in the current plan, as we discussed earlier. On species, there are some really good signs that NatureScot are thinking, and the NGOs are aligning in terms of getting agreement on which of the species are the ones that require that targeted work. The process isn't finished yet. It's called Species at Risk. It is being led by NatureScot, but it's very collegiate, and I think that's going in the right direction. But we have a long way to go. The State of Nature report shows that still, on average, we are losing wildlife in this country, and so there is that long way to go. Translocation is simply one conservation tool that can be used to achieve these ends. Okay, so there are a number of other conservation tools that one can use in tackling invasive non-native species, for example. And there is a signal in the delivery plan to a new plan for invasive non-native species in Scotland, which we really welcome and look forward to working with government on. But again, there's no kind of meat on the detail there yet.
Sounds to me from what you're saying that's quite an important plan to be developed at good pace.
A very important plan to be developed, and we've got some very clear ideas from the NGO sector as to how that we might work together with government on that one.
Dr. Brown, I noticed you positively expressing yourself to some of those comments made. Was there anything that you wanted to add?
No, the Institute is much more concerned with planning and the operation of the planning system, so I'm leaving the species and habitats and ecosystems to my colleagues on the panel.
Sure, thank you. Mr. Wilson?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned specifically impacts of beaver there, and this, you know, your previous question was about alignment with agriculture. When the secondary legislation comes through and we get specific schemes developed, there absolutely needs to be a space within that for helping and rewarding farmers for working with beavers and the natural flood management, massive natural flood management benefits they provide. We also need to look at the potential to use those schemes for other species programmes that we want to develop as well. And, you know, I do try and talk about benefits wherever I can. You know, another species programme we're closely involved in is Saving Scotland's Red Squirrels. And there's all sorts of really important ecological and kind of moral reasons why we should try and preserve species in Scotland. But actually, the control that we've taken on you know, amongst the partners within Saving Scotland's Red Squirrels on grey species has really helped when it comes to the rollout of native woodland and forest. I think a lot of people appreciate that grey squirrels are a real threat to the establishment of woodlands. So that would in turn impact our native woodland targets, our goals on climate, all sorts of other things that are benefiting from these species-specific programmes as well.
Thank you. And Sarah Cowie, you wanted to...
Thanks. Firstly, we agree that recovery of species is important, especially you know, our important native species. Efforts to do that are admirable, and we would completely support that. And I didn't get a chance to give our views on the nature networks, but if I could just do so quickly here, I think that nature networks actually provide a real chance and a real opportunity to link up good things that are happening among Scotland and especially on farms as well. So they can be a real opportunity for farmers to showcase the good work that they're doing. And when it comes to species abundance and the decline of species, you know, farmers know better than anyone what has declined and what's increased on their farm, and they can definitely tell you trends over the years of what they've seen and what they know has changed. But just to touch on species management and species reintroductions in general, I think that there's a lot that we can learn from the way we've done things here in Scotland already. I do think we, as NFU Scotland, do think we need a review of the current species licensing system. A lack of tools in the toolbox for land managers to manage conflict species is an issue. And we would actually go so far as to say that species mismanagement and a lack of balance can impact biodiversity. It obviously impacts on some farms, but it can impact other species as well. And I think that needs to be re-looked at in order to ensure that farmers and crofters have those tools to manage certain species. When it comes to species reintroductions, you know, there will be conflicts in some areas, and I don't think we can shy away from the problems that some reintroductions will present. More consideration has to be given to those who are adversely impacted. There will be the right place for things, there will be you know, the perfect habitat for certain things, but there will be other areas where it will have an impact on livelihoods and on farming businesses. So we think sufficient risk assessments need to be undertaken to ensure that those are fully taken into account, and that the impacts that they'll have on rural industries and on other species are fully taken into account. We also need to think about compensation and appropriate management measures for those who are negatively impacted. You know, we hear evidence of crop losses because of beavers or livestock losses as a result of sea eagles, and I think this is a really valid and important part of the conversation that we can't shy away from. It's not to say that we can never have these things in Scotland and we should never, you know, reintroduce species, but it's about being really honest about the impacts, negative and positive, that they will have.
Okay. Ilsa, Raymond, did you want to add anything, or are you content? No, nothing.
Fine, thank you.
Thanks, Convener.
Have you finished, Ben, on those? Yep.
Yeah, thank you.
I've just got a couple of questions, if I may, just on this. I think it's very interesting, and Paul, I thought it was interesting the mention of the state control in Orkney, which I think has cost us £60 million, or will do by the time we've got to the end of the project. You know, it is necessary, I fully accept that, but it's... Where I don't understand is who draws the line. So, for example, we'd probably like to see white stork back into Scotland and across the United Kingdom. Probably like to see the common tree frog, you know, two very easy species to manage. We might be a bit more reticent about seeing wild boar. In fact, I'd be very conscious that I don't want to see wild boar in Scotland ripping up our woodlands. They might be able to control ponticum on the west coast, but maybe... not elsewhere, you know, wolf, lynx, and we've got beaver coming back. But we seem to introduce these things without considering control. So for the perfect example is Abernethy, which Paul, you'll know very well, and I know very well, and the need to protect Cap Cayley. But we seem to allow Pine Marten to run riot on, and which definitely does affect the ground nesting birds. So do you think there needs to be in this plan a more persuasive and clear management plan, which could mean that we have to manage species within zones, like we're doing agriculture within zones or trees within zones, and accept that we can't have everything running all over the place? I'll go to you, Paul, and then Sarah.
I think these decisions are made collectively. I mean, there is a forum on reintroductions in Scotland which considers these points, like you know, white stork, for example. But legally speaking, you know, you can release species that are native to this country. So, in terms of this sort of strategic control, I think it needs to be seen in the context of a wider programme of species recovery. We have to remember that the key point we're trying to address in a biodiversity delivery plan is how we actually stop nature losses. And some species, like beaver, frankly, I find the scientific literature around the wider biodiversity benefits of beaver is quite extraordinary. I don't know anything quite like it. They have a hugely positive impact on a vast range of other biodiversity. And I thought it was really measured comments from Sarah really about how we do this and how we manage beavers now. The RSPB has made our own land available for the translocation of problem beavers onto our land. I think that kind of approach can work quite well. It's about getting it right in the right place, which, again, I'm sorry, brings us back to this spatial element to the strategy, which does seem to be lacking, which we sort of had the germ of in the land use strategy that we really need to bring up to the fore again and to do it quickly. But I think in terms of species licensing, there is a review has been signalled in this in the biodiversity framework consultation. And I think it is due to come this year, isn't it, later on this year? And it's in that process that we need to consider the detail of which species need to be regulated where. But I would caution the committee in confusing the human introduction of a predator onto an island ecosystem like stoats in Orkney, which has obviously globally significant biodiversity, sites for biodiversity, habitats and species, and the recovery of a native predator like pine martens. And we would doubt, actually, whether we really need to knock back pine martens in order for capercaillie to recover. I think what we really need for capercaillie to recover is their habitat to actually be at the right extent. I mean, Caledonian pine, you're smiling, convener, but Caledonian pinewood is at about 1% of its original extent. It is highly fragmented, and that means that you have the edge effect, in terms of the edge of woodland in relation to the centre of woodland habitat, is far, far greater now, and you have these predation issues as a result of that. I do think it needs to be seen in the round alongside.
I do very much take that point, and having re-established under grant schemes for people that I work for over 800 acres of Caledonian pine in the Cairngorms National Park and protected willow and aspen, which are two of the main species that beavers thrive on, along woodland edges, which were there to protect riparian habitats. I see conflict, and all I'm trying to say is should we accept that management needs to be in the plan, Sarah?
Absolutely, yes, we accept and believe that management should be a part of this. Nature is so complex and biodiversity itself is so complex that, you know, increases in one species will have an impact on others and vice versa. So we really have to look at this in the round and understand that, you know, human activity and human involvement in this will have consequences. What we believe that the government should do is try and assess what those consequences are as far as possible so that they can then mitigate them. I think a large part of that is actually understanding what is it we want to achieve. And I think the examples cited were very valid in that, you know, as I say, there will be different impacts, there will be different consequences, but really understanding what is it that we want to achieve, what species do we want to see thrive, what do we want to protect and improve is really key. And management is undoubtedly a part of that. As I mentioned in the last answer, the risks of not managing species, I think, are so great and can actually have a detrimental impact on biodiversity that we really can't not include species management as part of this. And, you know, it's not black and white either. It's not we'll have all of something and nothing of something else. That's what management is about. It's about control and it's about balance.
Please don't get me wrong. I'm all for stoats being wiped out of Orkney. Should never have got there in the first place. And maybe we should be doing something about controlling how they got there or looking at that to make sure it never happens.
Absolutely. And please don't get me wrong. I mean, I'm not anti-management of species. The RSPB manages species. We manage deer in a very large scale, for example. Yeah. So there's no in-principle disagreement here.
Okay.
It's all about the detail.
I could spend all day talking about this. I'm not allowed to because I need to come to Monica. And Monica, the questions are yours.
Thank you, Convener. I'm really enjoying this session. It's nice to be back in Parliament. And I think just reflecting on the early questions about engagement, I think you've all demonstrated why we need that early engagement and genuine and meaningful co-production. But my questions are on Objective 5, which is invest in nature. And I know the Biodiversity Investment Plan was mentioned earlier on. So we know the draft plan commits to develop a biodiversity investment plan, and that will set out, or should set out, strategic priorities for public investment. So I'm keen to understand what has been learnt to date about effective public funding of nature restoration, and where does investment need to be prioritised, and maybe if you could say a word or two on whether current funding commitments reflect the urgency of the nature crisis, which has been articulated today. So I'll maybe come to Bruce first of all.
Yeah, I thought the investment plan would come up again, so I didn't elaborate on it too much. You're quite right that the wording in the draft talks about how public money might be invested. That concerns me a little bit because I think everyone is well aware that the Scottish Government has said that this will not only be about public funding. There is a role for the private sector, blended finance, all sorts of other approaches in there as well. So if we only consider the public money here, we're missing part of the picture because we've been told that, that this will relate to private investments as well. And the second part of your question almost comes into the answer in that this has to be about the spatial prioritisation. It's very hard to look at that investment plan without also having the spatial prioritisation in front of you. So, for example, if we were to look at beavers, could there be a shout in certain catchments to have a riparian management zone to really prioritise riverside woodlands, riparian zones within 5 to 10 metres of the water course to really keep beavers within that area and effectively manage the problem? We can't really know that, and we can't really know the level of investment until we've done that spatial prioritisation aspect of things as well.
Okay. Please indicate if you want to come in, but I don't know if Paul wants to.
What I would add to that, and I agree with what Bruce said, but I think we need to face reality that there are markets emerging around biodiversity. There is a long history of speculation around Scottish land, which personally has been a bit of a concern. I actually think that one of the big challenges facing the Scottish Government is I think they're going to have to try and regulate these markets. And the function of that regulation, in my view, will be to achieve integrity, to ensure that when we do have private finance coming into fund biodiversity, as the Scottish Government has made clear, it is going to be essential, and I agree with that. But I think in order to make sure that standards are maintained and that it actually delivers real nature gain in terms of ecosystems and species again, I think that those markets are going to need some form of regulation. Now, I'm not an economist, I'm an ecologist, but it really strikes me that there is potential for greenwashing where people say, yeah, we're doing all this, it's all great for nature. And in fact, it is, you know, regimented rows of sitka spruce or the equivalent. There's massive potential for real gain here, and it's potential we have to grasp. But it really has to be done with great care, I think, or we may end up in a situation where something that was ostensibly intended to be to deliver for biodiversity actually does the reverse. Mm-hmm. That's my feeling.
That's I'm keen to bring in others, but just building on that, because I wanted to then touch on the role of private in investment, because I think Bruce is right, that's the reality. But some stakeholders have raised concerns that there's an apparent reliance in the draft plan on private investment approaches. And I think, Paul, your points about regulation, about integrity, they're obviously key points. So what Do people agree with the government strategy to promote responsible investment in natural capital? What does that look like? And government, as you know, are looking to expand the use of woodland and peatland codes and exploring biodiversity credits. We've heard some of the fears around potential greenwashing as well, particularly with some of the big polluters. So I know Sarah wants to come in, but I can come back to Bruce on that. But just keen to hear a range of different views, if there are any.
With everything that Paul said about regulating the market and making sure that it's robust and it's not greenwashing. So we completely agree with that. We agree with the government's intention to create this responsible market, but we are sceptical about the over-reliance on private finance. You know, we know that the public finance isn't going to, you know, plug the gap of everything that we want to achieve. So there is going to be a requirement for private finance, but we shouldn't be too over-reliant on it. And I can't speak too technically to the nature market side of things, but I do know what our members tell us about this emerging markets. Some people see opportunities, and we think that there could be opportunities down the line, but at present, a lot of people feel like they're just too underdeveloped, they're too risky to have confidence in just yet. We've also got quite a complicated pattern of land ownership in Scotland and the way that farming operates. It can be complicated. You've got landowners, and you might have farmers who own the land, farming the land, but you'll also have tenant farmers, you'll have crofters, and there's a lot of unanswered questions around private finance and how those will work with those different individuals and how those relationships will interact. So people are very hesitant to tie themselves into a potentially 10 to 20 year scheme that it then comes back to bite them. There's also there's also a role to play here for retailers as well. They're asking more and more of their the people that supply to them, which can also come into the mix as well. So I think there's just a lot of unanswered questions around what this is actually going to mean in the long term. Of course, as well, science and evidence changes. We might be going down a path that in 5 years think that's no longer appropriate. So if people are tied into contracts, how is that going to impact their business, and how are they going to, you know, get out of that if it's no longer relevant? So essentially, there's just a lot of unanswered questions that need to be ironed out, and I don't think we can just look at this in a Scottish perspective. We have to look UK, we have to look internationally. That brings with it added complications, but it's necessary to kind of look at that in the round as well, essentially.
Thank you, Sarah. I'll bring in Ailsa, but just sticking with Sarah for a moment. So you've been clear that there's lots of unknowns, but from a sort of farming, crofting perspective, what would you say are the main risks and opportunities of pursuing private investment in Scotland's natural capital?
As I've mentioned before, farmers are already doing a lot of great things for nature, and the opportunities and potential of increased natural capital and nature-based solutions and all those sort of great things, for farmers to get paid for doing that is a massive opportunity for them, and for private companies, for the public, for society as a whole to recognise that is the opportunity. The risks are the greenwashing. The risks are farmers are being taken advantage of. The risks are being tied into contracts that they can't get out of, or, you know, stipulation changes down the line and that they're then stuck in something that they weren't aware of at the beginning. So we just don't know enough about how these markets work and the robustness of them, the integrity of them. That all needs to be ensured before going forward. And I think, as I've mentioned before as well, we do know that there's an agricultural reform coming, with the bill is coming through Parliament, but there's still some uncertainty. We still are lacking some details, and so people may be hesitant to commit to these markets before all the full detail is realised, and that goes for the delivery plan as well. We need to know the full details before we can commit.
Thank you. Ailsa, you've been waiting patiently, so I'll come to you next.
Thanks very much. Yeah, no, this is an area of particular concern to communities for all sorts of reasons. And I think going back to one of the very earlier questions as to why we're not meeting our woodland and peatland restoration targets is that the finance is quite complicated. Landowners don't understand it. It seems very speculative. There's a lack of transparency. The regulation is not working. So I think we can learn lessons from woodland and peatland, and particularly from sort of the carbon rush and the impact that's had on the land markets and land values, which, as we all know, has effectively sort of meant that only the very wealthy now can trade in Scotland's land, and most farmers and crofters and individuals and communities are being priced out of the market. So I think there's a lot of lessons we can learn from how the carbon markets have and are working. I think the Scottish Government are doing some really interesting work around the responsible investment in natural capital, but that needs to be hugely strengthened in terms of that regulatory mechanism that will be put in place for carbon and for biodiversity credits when they do come to the market and they do impact on Scotland. So I think linked to that is also some of the proposals around land reform, about things like land management plans and how they work, public interest tests and how they could work, strengthening the land rights and responsibility statement. I think there's quite a lot of mechanisms that would actually address some of the concerns that Paul and Sarah have already outlined here. So again, it's not starting from scratch, it's building on ideas that are already being developed. I'm equally very sceptical on a reliance on private finance in this market, and think there's quite a lot that Scottish Government needs to do in terms of its thinking around the long-term impacts of introducing private finance at scale for biodiversity credits. Again, looking what's happening globally and looking what's happened in carbon and being able to review those impacts before we go down this line of thinking that actually private finance is the route to resolving this, because it will have some part to play, but we are at the very early stages of understanding what those impacts are, and I think is a real need for a big piece of work by Scottish Government to think about that and think about what those implications are, particularly for farmers and crofters and communities and those other organisations and individuals that want to engage in owning Scottish land and delivering that broad range of objectives that Scottish Government has for its land. Thank you.
Thank you, Ailsa. You packed a lot in there, really great on the record. I'll squeeze in the final question, convener, if that's okay, because I wanted to also cover objective six, which is taking action on the indirect drivers of biodiversity loss. So again, maybe just give me a wave if you want to come in. So the draft plan states that action will be taken to strengthen the connection between people and nature through nature positive developments and stewardship of public, community and private land. So keen to hear from our panel, what does nature positive development look like in practice, and do we have a blueprint for this in Scotland? I don't know if Caroline wants to come in here.
Thanks. A small question. There are lots of good examples of how this can be done, and we need to think about the design of nature-positive developments, what that looks like. We need to think also about the post-occupancy phase, sort of put it in that technical way, but what happens when people, you know, take over the houses or occupy their buildings and what they do, because the planning designing stage is a few years and potentially the lifetime of that building or that place, and we need to think about that placekeeping part, and I think there's a huge potential around that. I had a conversation with a taxi driver about Suds and Sheffield once, and he said, "What? Why would you plant things in the middle of the road?" And I said, "Because it's about flooding." And we had this amazing conversation. He went, "Okay, I get it." He understood that investing in that type of planting, rain gardens in a street, could help to alleviate flood problems and save money in the long term. And I think we need to have these conversations, and there's best practice out there, but it has to be shared. And if we go back to this action plan, the sort of top line about communicating and engaging with communities about this, the question is, who is going to do it? And, you know, who are they going to talk to? And yeah, who's going to lead on that activity? Because there's huge potential to get communities on board with this. And I come back to things like local place plans might be a way of helping to do that placekeeping. Not just thinking about new development, but about how we steward the existing developments.
I love that anecdote about chatting to the taxi driver about SUDs. It's the kind of thing that I would do as a planner at heart. The People's Plan for Nature does call for more locally managed green spaces, which might fit with that point you made about what happens after sites are built out and occupied. So that role for community stewardship is really important. So Ailsa might want to come back in, but does anyone else want to briefly say anything on this theme before I hand back to the convener?
Local authorities need to take advantage of the nature network tools to help plan these places and help connect communities with things that they want to do. So the sort of nature network side of things might be quite technical, but the projects that are delivered on the ground under them don't need to have any kind of nature network tag associated with them. They can just be community-led projects, but the local authority needs to use the opportunity mapping tool to try and work out the best places to connect those communities with land they might want to try and restore.
I think we're getting the message that mapping is very important. Yes,
I don't
that.
Know if you picked her hand, and yes. I think Paul is waving as well.
If there's time, Ilse, then Paul. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, I think. Okay, yeah, thank you. Yeah, just coming back to sort of the previous point about opportunities for communities to engage in rural land are getting fewer and fewer for the reasons we outlined. But I think some really interesting examples are coming forward in the urban communities, and Ben McPherson touched on some of them already. But if you look at what the community will be doing at View Park, just by the M8, you know, they've got 160-odd acres there that they're completely turning over to a lot of the type of work we're talking about here. That's quite a big scale, but on a very small scale, you've got a lot of sort of little pocket parks, and you've got community gardens and small parks, etc., that communities are very, very engaged in. And anything that the biodiversity strategy and delivery plan can do to really encourage that at a very small local scale will not only contribute to the objectives of the strategy and delivery plan, but also deliver all those other benefits, which we talked about, health and wellbeing and regeneration, but also addressing things like vacant and derelict land, which we know in Glasgow and Dundee in particular are huge issues. So I think the work of the Nature Network is really interesting, but it is about getting it down to that very local level, making the delivery mechanisms easy to understand and accessible for local people to engage. Thank you.
Thank you. And Paul, final word.
I think education has a really key role here, actually. So I was cycling at the clay pits that Bob Doris was talking about earlier just last weekend. I live in Glasgow. Absolutely amazing example of best practice, a good practice that Caroline was referring to. Lessons can be learned, and it's fantastic. But I also met a GP recently who has a practice right next to Pollock Park, and she says that the most of the people she works with in the housing schemes right next to Pollock Park, which won European Park of the Year a few years back, just don't go to it because they think it's kind of not for them. You know, so I do think there is a kind of social effect happening here where it's kind of nature is seen as a bit, maybe that's no for ordinary folk, it's for experts kind of thing. And I really think that, you know, all of us here, including the NGOs, can play a part in this. But the real answer, I suspect, lies in education and making sure that part of our education system puts children in touch with nature so that they feel that it's quite natural. Post-Second World War, local nature reserves, the original function of them was education, as an educational resource. And I think these local green spaces should be formally utilised as educational resources to break down some of those barriers.
I agree. Back to you, Convener.
Perfect. Thank you. And now I'm going to bring in to Rhoda Grant, and then I'm going to go to Finlay Carson. So, Rhoda, if you could try and direct your questions at a couple of people. We are pushed on time, as always, on this committee. But, Rhoda, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. I've just got a couple of quick finance-related questions. The first one, I'll direct Paul Warden, because he talked about funding for biodiversity and how it was often insufficient in the crofting areas and small farming areas and could often lead to abandonment. The previous schemes tended to, I suppose, reward farms and the like that had the greatest number of features or habitats that could be restored or protected, and that meant that small holdings were left out. What can we do with the new scheme to make sure that doesn't happen and those places where that have the best practices are rewarded and encouraged to keep their features?
In a word, I would say the spatial approach. I mean, you can't just sort of say, oh, let's invent a piece of biodiversity and put it somewhere randomly. It has to have that biogeographic sense. So I do think if we have that spatial element to our biodiversity delivery plan, that should then direct the funding to the right places. And some work at small scale can be hugely valuable. And one of the things we'd really like to see is a re-energising of the idea of collaboration and cooperation between different land managers via the agricultural and land management support system, so that we get that collaboration, which I think its delivery has been patchy to date. I think that's really important, particularly for smaller holdings.
Thank you. My second question is about private finance and investment, and maybe direct this to Ailsa, although I know a number of the people on the panel had something to say. I suppose the basic question is, what does private finance have to gain by investment? Because the fear is, as was stated before, that causes greenwashing, inflation in land prices. So therefore, it looks like this is being sold on to make profits for private financiers. And I suppose the other concern is that selling this on could tie the hands of land managers. And we all know that things change very quickly. And when we see different actions taking place, that that could have a negative impact. So I guess, where are the benefits? One, to biodiversity, but two, for the private financiers, what is actually meaning that they will get involved in this kind of finance?
So we go to Ailsa first, and I notice Paul sort of, I think, nodding, wanting to come in, and Bruce, so we could do it in that order.
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Yes, I think, again, we can look at what's happened in the carbon markets and read over then to what might happen in an emerging biodiversity credit market in Scotland. So it's hard to see at the moment how that is going to generate sufficient income in the short term to repay private investment. So a lot more work is required on thinking around that, because a lot of this is very speculative. Obviously, in the carbon market, there's perhaps an anticipation that at some point there'll be carbon taxes coming forward, and people are trying to get themselves on the front foot around being able to offset their carbon emissions. But it's a bit more difficult to see that from a biodiversity credit point of view, as opposed to the sort of English system of biodiversity net gain. So the colleagues will probably have more to contribute on that. I think a lot of this is around socialising risk, but privatising reward. So we're anticipating there will be a lot of public finance going in at the front end to enable some of this biodiversity work to happen. But actually, where is the reward coming? The financial reward. And again, I think that speaks to a much stronger system of regulation and understanding of how these markets work, because I'm just not convinced in Scotland we do understand how they will work for Scotland's land and Scotland's people. So I think it's a big piece of work Scottish Government to do. There's huge issues around transparency and opaqueness and actually financialisation of land. Who owns these credits? Who can enforce them? We know we don't really have legal mechanisms at the moment to enable that long-term enforcement, particularly when assets transfer. And you've mentioned the issue of permanence. And yes, this is a huge issue for us at the moment, but in 10, 15, 20 years, there'll be another huge issue. And are we actually tying up our land resources and assets for a very long period of time for a particular issue now, when actually we need more flexibility? So I think there's such a lot of unanswered questions. And I think Sarah, from a sort of farmers and Crofter's perspective, picked up a lot of that nervousness around why communities and landowners are not engaging and why we're not meeting the woodland and peatland targets, because we don't have clarity. And those owners and crofters and communities all understand the issue of permanence in a way that perhaps financial markets don't understand the issues of permanence. Thank you.
Bruce, I think you're going to answer
Ailsa's done a really great job of outlining those risks, which I share. And you know, I don't think other people are nodding away vigorously as well. Ailsa's done a great job also of trying to articulate the difference between carbon credits, which is, as complicated as that is, relatively easy, versus nature markets. You're dealing with a sort of completely non-fungible thing in nature, whereas carbon, you know, a ton of carbon is the same in any part of the world. Nature is different if you move it 15 metres further away. So these things are very, very difficult to work with. You also then start to see confusion between things like biodiversity net gain and carbon credits and everything. So it very quickly becomes incredibly complicated. And one thing that we can do practically is straight away try and move the interim principles that we've already mentioned onto a far more firmer footing. The place in my mind to do that is the Natural Environment Bill. The voluntary principles that are there at the moment, I have seen some investors follow them, and that's great. But you know, I was lucky enough to be with Finlay during the summer at one of our reserves down there, and there's an awful lot of woodland planting going on, which a lot of people's minds is natural capital investment. They're certainly not following any principles there for those investments. Be that whether that's actually a natural capital investment or a straight up just forestry investment, the perception is that those are now natural capital investments. So we need to be moving quite quickly to try and put those onto a statutory footing.
It's a huge process for absolutely politicians and government in relation to what's going on the ground, which seems to be going well in front of them. But anyway, Finn. You've got some questions.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I had a New Year's resolution to be positive in the new year, and sadly, it's no reflection on the fantastic contribution that our witnesses have given today, but looking at the strategy, I feel it's as depressing as a Christmas turkey on Boxing Day. It really has no meat on the bones whatsoever, and that's what worries me. On a daily basis, we hear Mary McCallum talk about the nature crisis and how we need to go faster and further. This doesn't do any of that. You've really struggled to touch on the positives that the strategy has, but the negatives of what is not in the strategy are really in our face. So one of the positives, a non-invasive, non-native invasive species. I've been in this parliament since 2016. We've been talking about it for the last 8 years, and you're still saying, but we need more detail. River catchment policies, we've had a land use strategy that sat in the shelf for goodness knows how many years. We've got an agriculture bill, we're right at the business end of that, and we still have, even though they're supposed to be a kind of joint effort, we have one organisation saying 80% should be in Tier 1, and we have another organisation saying 25%. We're only weeks away from putting into place laws around that, and we're still not there. I'm disappointed that there's the feeling that there was no realistic engagement, because we really need to be able to communicate the significant impacts that the policies that we're going to need to deliver the huge task of reversing biodiversity loss is. We're still not there. So my question is, has there really been genuine co-production on this strategy, given some of the issues that you've raised, which will, as Sarah said, you know, empower farmers, will empower people to accelerate the delivery of biodiversity restoration, because it doesn't appear that we're there at the moment. You know, we had a 17.6% cut in the agri-environment budget, which doesn't send a very good signal either to farmers that the work that they're doing is being valued, or indeed that biodiversity should play a huge role in our future food production. So, question, is this genuine co-production, or do we need to do a lot more to get a far better joined-up approach to biodiversity?
Is for me to say to each of you, give a yes, no answer, but that's not going to work, I know that. But could I ask you to keep them short, because I know you'll all have views on this. And Finn, if you're happy, work along the line from Bruce through to Caroline and then to Ailsa.
I'm afraid to say for the majority of this, it has not felt like genuine co-production. I think there's definitely work to do in engaging wider stakeholder groups, particularly delivery partners on the ground. What will be crucial is the governance of how this moves forward. And that is a very important thing to now start to work and get right.
Yeah, we need non-government leaders on the Strategic Biodiversity Council. But I think we need to acknowledge that efforts were made to develop co-design across government, which took up an awful lot of time and effort and have had quite patchy outputs in the end. I think the real hope for securing proper mainstreaming across government it centres around the legally binding targets for nature and natural environment bill. So I think there's absolutely everything to play for. And I actually think that to have ministers and cabinet secretaries talking about a nature emergency is a huge bit of progress, because the government narrative previously has been Scotland's great for nature, look outside your window, it's beautiful, there is no problem. I think acknowledging that there is an issue is the first step to actually doing the right thing. So actually I think there's a bit more meat on your turkey, Finlay, this Boxing Day, and I do think that the direction of travel that's signalled by the whole biodiversity framework is very positive.
No, we also don't think that there's been enough engagement and enough co-design engaging with our Environment and Land Use Committee on the list of actions. There was disappointment, actually, that farmers weren't engaged on coming up with that list. You know, you're given a list and you're asked what your opinions are on it, but farmers could have actually used, you know, their creativity, their experience, their expertise to influence what that list said. And we just hope that there will still be a chance, even though the consultation deadline is passed, to still have an input on what the final action plan looks like. And also, crucially as well, I think a lot of the actions in the plan, they are existing commitments, they are existing things, but they don't really address why some things haven't reached their potential already. So there's no kind of engagement with industry or with the sector on lessons that could be learned going forward. So I think that's two main points.
Completely agree. So no, definitely not co-produced, and lots of potential for more of that to be happening as this goes forward. There's a lot of very useful things in here, but as we've all said, you know, we need to have more detail about who's leading, who's going to be delivering, what timescales, what the priorities are, the spatial context, and you know, how this interfaces and interacts with those other work programmes. So Nature Scots work programme, the government's work programme on NPF4 and planning, etc., etc., and, you know, economic strategies and all of those other things. So there's potential here. I think we all see the potential, and I also agree about the changing narrative, which is really valuable. It's high level. We see it in national planning policy. We're seeing it here. We're seeing it in lots of other places, the recognition of the dual crisis of climate and nature emergency. That in itself is a change, but in terms of delivery, there's still more meat to be put on those turkey bones.
Yeah, thank you. I'd agree with colleagues there that the wider sort of community stakeholder groups haven't been consulted, or I'm not aware that they've been consulted. And we know from previous types of policy, particularly around highly protected marine areas, without that consultation, you immediately get a sort of a defensive reaction, which then undermines all of the good objectives that everyone's trying to achieve here. So I think there is more work to do there. And there's also more work to do around how community at a very local level can contribute effectively and appropriately at a local scale. So that is something that's very easily done, looking at projects that are already underway and that are successful. But I think that piece of sort of broader community engagement and broader public engagement still required to be done, so we avoid those sort of immediate defensive reactions. Thank you.
And the one question that none of you asked within Finn's question was there enough money to achieve all of this, and where that's coming from. And maybe that's the hanging question at the end of it, because we are out of time. Thank you very much for your evidence session this morning and coming here and giving evidence, and also for doing it so well online, so I knew exactly when you'd finished at the appropriate moment to bring the next person in. So thank you very much. The committee will be considering the evidence that we've been given, and we will also later this month we'll hear from the Scottish Government's plan in relation to this, and we're going to move into private session. I'd ask committee members to be back here by 11:35, ready to do that. So that concludes the public part of the meeting. Thank you.